So a disclaimer from the get-go is that I actually didn't get to spend all that much time with Disco Elysium, so it might have actually ended up higher on the list. However, what I did love was the murder mystery story mixed in with RPG elements and proper choice and consequences. On top of that is the great writing, which really drags you into scenarios, whether it's the witty back and forth of the multiple personalities or different voices inside your character's head, or funny bits such as running away from a hotel clerk because he's forcing you to pay for the damages to the room you've rented out. The biggest thing I love about the game though is the transparency. You can see a breakdown of the skill checks you pass or fail throughout a conversation, meaning that if you do fail it, you can just restart the game, go back and try different options to see if you can get a higher score. Now the bad sides. The game does not autosave enough, which can lead to you losing hours and hours of progress. On top of that, there's far too many traits and skills to put points into, so you're always going to miss something, no matter how thorough you are. However, my brief fling with the game has left me definitely wanting more, and that's why it's number 5 on my list. How could I not put Far Cry New Dawn on my list when I was such a massive fan of Far Cry 5? High quality first person shooting, as well as some of the best play your way stealth going. Stealth feels like a genuine option, but so does just going in guns blazing. The world itself is just different enough from the previous game to make you feel the need to go and explore it all over again. Not only that, but the post-apocalyptic landscape is genuinely beautiful in parts due to the fantastic use of colour throughout. And some of the levels are really fun, like infiltrating a prison to kill the warden, participating in a death race, and participating in a fight club. Now towards the end of the game there is the addition of superpowers, but somehow it works, it doesn't feel too wacky and they're actually so useful, you end up relying on them a lot more than you think you would. Now, the villains. So the villains in Far Cry are usually fantastic. However, Lou and Mickey, they're a lot of missed potential, as their best moments only come towards the end. And finally, the boss fights are just not fun at all. They don't challenge what you've learnt throughout, like in the previous game. They're just chaotic and at most times frustrating. Absolutely not a patch on the Far Cry 5 boss fights. However, this game still stands up on its own 2 feet well enough that it be considered my number 4. How long has it been since there's been a core Kingdom Hearts game? Too long. But somehow Kingdom Hearts 3 lives up the crazy expectation that came along with it. The combat, it's fun, it's flashy, and apart from the last few boss fights, never feels unfair. And the novelty hasn't worn out from visiting all these different worlds and interacting with these famous characters. And somehow they've been able to make all these worlds feel different in their own ways, whether it's the Toy Story world feeling more like a traditional Kingdom Hearts, whereas Tangled World feels massive and sprawling. And they have all these different mechanics introduced throughout the world as well, like in the Pirates of the Caribbean there's ship fights and underwater sections, or in Toy Story there's mech gameplays. It is just mind-blowing how much they've been able to fit into this game and make everything seem so pretty, as see some of the boss fights, they are actually on Final Fantasy 15 levels of epic. The Titans in Olympus, the Tar Heartless in Tangled, and the UFO Heartless in Toy Story, friggin' just bleh. I'm not going to use friggin' just blah. But this is a Kingdom Hearts game, and at the end of the day, I still have no clue what is going on in the story. And I don't find the characters interesting. There's no real arcs to them, Sora's kind of always upbeat and just whatever. However, a game that delivers 14 years of expectation was bound to be on my Game of the Year list, and that's why Kingdom Hearts is number 3. I can sell you the Outer Worlds in one quick sentence. It's like Fallout but with all the crap cut away, and that's pretty much the angle they were going for with all their advertisements for it. This is a team who knows how to build a world, and they do that fantastically. Not only that, there's good gameplay elements to back that up. The combat is actually really enjoyable once you get down to the nitty gritty and use everything at your disposal, whether it's the slow motion, your companions, or the environment. The lore of the world's pretty cool as well, with the idea that corporations have bought over even the furthest parts of space. That actually kind of pales in comparison to the actual stories from your companions, which are the real standout moments. Whether it's Ellie trying to come across as tough and hardened, but in reality she's just a spoilt wee girl, or Max trying to overcome his demons and find peace through religion, or my babe Parvati navigating the struggles of trying to have an asexual relationship. At the end of the day, This was always going to be compared to a Fallout game, and you do kind of miss the scale that comes with an actual sandbox, as the Outer Worlds goes for a series of smaller hubs, which initially is not a bad point, but then when you realise the game was only about 20 hours long, you kind of think it's not as epic as they once made it out to be, especially whenever you complete the game and there's still three planets left locked. And these planets, although they do look very different, they all feel very similar, so they're just open plains with a big, weird metal road going through it and the occasional clutter of boxes to use against enemies. Overall, I absolutely adored The Outer Worlds, and it filled that hole while I wait for Fallout 5. If you had told me that when we started this channel back in like 2014, 15, that 2 years in a row I would have a Pokemon game on my Game of the Year list, I probably would have spat in your face. But here we are, and for the second year in a row, Pokemon is in my top 5 with Pokemon Sword and Shield. It's a traditional Pokemon game that has new additions which brings it into the modern days. It's taken the necessary things from Pokemon Let's Go and brought them into this game. They've even built upon some of these ideas, with Pokemon in the overworld being either aggressive or neutral or fleeing from you, which makes the world feel so alive, especially in the wild area, which is exactly what we've been wanting from a Pokemon game for years. A massive open area seeing Pokemon wander about and live their daily lives. It does make it disappointing to know that this is not across the entire game, but it's definitely a step in the right direction. They've even introduced a wee bit more story throughout the entire thing, which is definitely welcomed. However, they need to do a bit more with it, as the story only really starts to take off toward the end of the game and post game. Even if they formatted it like the TV series, where every town had its own small narrative, that'd be a really welcome addition. My biggest gripe comes with the unnecessary padding at the very end, where you have to face all the gym leaders again in the final run up to the champion, which is completely unnecessary. I've beaten them before, I'm going to beat them again, just let me fight the champion. All in all, the reason I think Pokemon Sword and Shield is my game of the year is because this is definitely aimed at people who grew up with Pokemon. The protagonists aren't the wee 10-year-olds anymore from Red and Blue. They've grown up, they're more like teenagers, or else really tall 10-year-olds. But as I get older and I'm very quickly racing towards the big 3-0, with the stresses of adult life piling on top of me, why would I not gravitate towards a game that makes me feel like I'm 9 years old again, and all the stresses and problems that we have just melt away, as I'm more concerned about facing the next gym leader or catching a Pikachu? And if a game can make all my worries disappear and take me back to feeling like a kid again, how could it not be my number one game of the year?